Hi everybody, this is Abhyuday. Welcome to the session. Today we've taken a very different topic. We've taken a topic of how to build a video CV and other alternative strategies to sort of combat the COVID lockdown. I have a very specific purpose for this, and before jumping into how to get into this, let's look at why. Okay, so all of you are currently in one way or another impacted by the lockdown. Most of you are unable to visit. Most of you are unable to go to office. You may be working from home. Some of you might have felt that there is lesser work coming from office. In some organizations, there is a pay cut that is also being given to a lot of employees. People are uncertain about are these jobs going to be safe? How long the lockdown will continue? A lot of these things are happening around, and you may be bothered by this. Okay. Now, there is something we've been doing apart from everyday webinars and, you know, doing our regular work. What we do in our company is, in the morning call that we have, there are certain people in our team, about 12 of us, get together and we discuss how we're going to plan things. But not only do we plan that, we discuss what are we supposed to prepare for in this COVID lockdown period, okay? And every day what is happening is things are changing, right? So the lockdown, as you saw, suddenly last Sunday there was one day of lockdown, then there was a week's or 2 weeks lockdown, and then there was an extension for 3 weeks. So the situation keeps changing a little, and therefore one has to build a new strategy, or one has to plan and account for it accordingly. Now, one thing that may be happening for a lot of you is anxiety and uncertainty, and where you don't know what else to do, right? So it's oversimplistic to say that, okay, take out this time and study an online course or something. Yeah, I get it. That is true. But how will it exactly help you, and what should you be looking at to grow in your career, or how can you sort of survive and ride this wave of the lockdown? Because this lockdown is going to leave permanent implications for the future. Okay. Some shifts are going to happen for a longer term. Okay. So not just this period till the lockdown, which is till April 15th, or in case it's extended for a longer period. This is a phase you have with you to do something that you want, but it's also after that, what are you going to do? And I'm seeing that there is a lot of gyan on the internet stating that, do your workout, have a schedule, write a book, read that book that you wanted, all of that. But sometimes that doesn't resonate, because the question of how does it add up to my career comes up, right? I've been reading that and I'm trying to connect with it. And when I do that, I find that this is a big challenge. How does it connect to my career is not clear. So I was thinking that how is it going to affect the life of a lawyer, CA, CS, and a law student? And when I speak to people on the phone, almost every day I have a few conversations. I can sense that people are waiting for internships to happen in July, June. And the level of preparation for what if people start downsizing? What if people stop hiring? What if the lockdown extends? What if I don't get my internship confirmed? All this planning has not been done, and people are not prepared for it. Okay. So in today's session, the agenda is to prepare for what may come. And if things are not very bright, then what are the actions we can take today so that we move forward? Okay. So usually, and I also want to share from our work, like how I divide my day. Okay. So in the morning, when we start off with this daily call that we have internally in the LawSikho team, it's the co-founders, the people working on counseling, marketing team, content team managers are there, operations team managers are there. Now, after that, we get into our daily work. But after the day gets over, which gets over between 8:30 to 10 or 11:30 p.m. for different people, right? After that, we look at the situation. I personally, individually look at the situation as to what may happen. Okay, if the lockdown gets more exacerbated, one side, or if things improve, both ways, what are the possible futures that we may be walking into post this lockdown? So I'm going to walk you through some of the thoughts that I have about what are the things that can happen. And then we are going to look at how or what you could do to prepare yourself for it. Okay, and then we can try out some mocks so that you try out ways of preparing and to ride this wave. Now, who is this for? This is for any professional CACS lawyer of any age group. Okay, and it is also, students are most welcome because this is going to have a very big impact on your future. I'm not saying adverse necessarily, it might be a great impact. Okay, but it's definitely going to have an impact on your future. And if you prepare for it, you might benefit. Okay. Now, so what are the implications that are going to happen? Let's just map what all has happened till date. What has happened till date is that in the curfews and lockdowns that have been imposed so far, people have not been able to go out and they are working from home, right? So remote collaboration is happening. And people are right now struggling with that. There are initial hiccups. And in some industries, the work has entirely vanished, like real estate sector, travel, hospitality. Not hospitals, hospitality, hotels, that is. Okay. These three sectors are very badly hit. Supply chain is hit, right? So manufacturing would be hit very badly. Essential services is the only thing that's working by and large. Even there, sometimes the police stops you, and unless you have a valid e-pass, you will not cross borders. And so cities like Delhi, which have connection with Haryana, UP, and Rajasthan on its borders, there are friction, right? People are unable to move. So now these are the industries that are impacted permanently, not permanently, for this period. And what is working, what is still happening, is industries where people can stay at home and work, right? Now, the service sector has been dependent on all of these industries. So all of our work gets interconnected. Now, this lockdown, whatever happens, is not going to last forever. Why am I saying that? Okay, because at some point in time, what's going to happen? So we, Ramanuj and I and our team were discussing. So we have seen the experience in other countries. In India also, we are watching it. So after a total lockdown, we may not be able to contain the spread of COVID. Okay, at whatever level we are able to contain it, eventually the choice for us will be, for the government will be, that should people die because of lack of food and lack of economic activity? Because the government will not have money to pay for the police, the security forces, all of them, right? So the choice will be whether to continue to be indoors and impose the lockdown, or to stop that, to remove the lockdown and have people go to work, okay? Selectively, wherever people are can stay work from home, they will work from home, but people will start moving out because there may be more adverse implications because of the lockdown on lives, like you're seeing how daily wages are being impacted. So more adverse implications may be there, okay, on everyday life owing to the lockdown than the harm that may be spread by COVID. And the harm that may be spread by COVID may in any way be inevitable. Okay, because you can have a 3-month lockdown and it will have lasting implications for the economy. But unless COVID itself is eradicated or the vaccine is ready, after 3 months when you open, the same thing's going to happen. Okay, so whatever is going to happen, whatever happens, your lockdown will be there, but eventually it will have to be opened up. Okay, so lockdown is going to be there for a limited period. Now, when the lockdown is removed, what is going to happen then? Things may not be exactly fully normal, like there may be a lot of work from home continuing. The practices and the way of interaction that are set now in this lockdown period are going to continue. Okay, so there could be some changes. And what I want to do for the next 15 minutes or 10 minutes is to map some of these changes. And then we go into how to ride, how to prepare for these. So we discussed about the impact on manufacturing, hospitality, right, real estate. Now, which are the what's going to happen after the lockdown eases out? So we were discussing internally that entire global supply chain was fed by China, right? In the sense that every company globally would have a manufacturing setup in China and distribution worldwide. Apple, every global company you can think of had that. And if you see there's an interview of Tim Cook on the website, on the net, and he says why that's the case. He said that in America, if I look for engineers for manufacturing, I may be able to find like a room full in a city. And if I do that in China, I will have a stadium full of them. Okay. And that is the reason why everything was based out of China. But now what's going to happen is that this event has shown that how much risk there is to the supply chain because of dependency on one country. So the moment lockdown is removed, companies are going to look for alternative manufacturing destinations. Which are those alternative manufacturing destinations? India is going to be a prime one, right? Because of availability of every resource you want, labor, land, resources, everything. India is going to be one of them. There will be other countries like Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Vietnam, Southeast Asian nations, but India is going to be up there. Okay. So manufacturing investments may increase. If investments are coming into India, that means M&A sector investment, joint venture work is going to continue. Okay. In today's day and time, what are lawyers doing? In today's day and time, right now, in-house counsels are, so I'm sharing the insights that we have been looking at. Okay. In-house counsels right now, or even any lawyer for any company is looking at, these are the deals that we have available to us. Okay. These are the contracts. Now, what can we do with these contracts? So one side of the story is that I look at force majeure, I look at frustration, I look at all of that. But the other side of the story is, so those would be highly litigious and risky calls to take, invoking force majeure, because you know, guaranteed that when the courts open up, there's going to be litigation, right? So that is next to a guarantee. But instead, so what are people also going to prefer is to open up conversations on existing contracts and renegotiate workable outcomes. So in contract drafting, people have to novate, amend, waive various rights that they would be otherwise enforcing. Okay. So what that does is it renegotiates the deal, keeps both parties secure. Okay, and reduces risk of litigation. Now, this work is going to be there a lot for lawyers. So this is what work, this is contract review, the negotiation. And in negotiation, this is not like a classical negotiation style. You're going to say that, okay, maybe I need to book expense by 31st March. I'm going to pay you a lump sum payment, but you give me a better deal than you were giving me earlier. Or you're going to say, I don't have any money, give me an extension on this. But the first step before you invoke any force majeure and any of that is to look at how you can renegotiate deals, because nobody wants unnecessary risk of litigation. So a lot of negotiation, a lot of letter drafting also is going to be there. Which letter? It's not a plain paper, regular letter. It's a legal styled letter pursuant to the contract you will be writing. In some cases, you will be executing an amendment agreement. Okay, you may not replace the original contract completely, but you may amend certain clauses of it. Or let's say there were specific invoices on which payment was due, you will get an extension, so you will get it formally recorded. Okay, all these things have to be done by lawyers right now. This is one piece of work that will be there for lawyers. Now, when this gets over, okay, what's going to happen? Now, as I said, in some cases, you'll be able to resolve and close out the risk. But in a lot of other cases, the risk will be open. Some people will not want to renegotiate deals. And if you're not able to pay, you have no option but to say, hey, I'm claiming force majeure. I'm claiming frustration. Now, you're very clear. That is a seed for litigation. So that means contract-based litigation and arbitration work is going to begin the moment things open up. One more thing that is possible is that, see, the lockdown may stop, may continue, whatever happens, till April end, April 15th. But now courts and judiciary has gone into a mode that things can be digitized. Okay, so once they start this, they are likely to adopt this across other judicial forums. So this is not going to stop. So you will soon have a time, maybe 3 months, 6 months, where all the forums are taking online filing, online arguments, all of that. It may start with tribunals first, or maybe Supreme Court and tribunals. Eventually, more courts will go digital. Okay, so this wave of digitalization, which is there, one is it's spreading to sectors which were not earlier digital, like courts. There may be other areas where digital work wasn't happening, but it will start. Like when the demonetization happened, people got so comfortable with digital payments, right? Now it's going to increase. That's going to go a notch up because of the fact that, because of what has just happened. So one is that your litigation work will increase the moment lockdowns are removed. Second is there may be a flattening of the legal field because you can argue, maybe a lawyer in Karnataka can represent a matter in Delhi. Unless they say that an NOR in Delhi High Court also has to be a Delhi Bar Council registered lawyer. Okay. Now, one thing Utkarsh is asking whether data protection laws litigation will increase. I am very sure it will, because as when everybody is going digital, what's going to happen is that they will go digital faster than the methods they will have to protect data, data misuse or data loss. Okay. So right now the personal data protection bill hasn't been notified, but assuming it was, or whenever it gets. So irrespective of whether the law is there or not, people will want data protection work in massive numbers because everything is going digital, which means there is digital trails of everything being left. So upskilling to technology related areas is going to become very, very important. So you will need to know various things around technology, not just data protection, but also even how to draft technology contracts. And one thing that comes with technology is that you need to start understanding technology as a discipline. Okay, like we were discussing in the webinar day before, that API, for example, okay, like what is API is application programming interface, but what does a lawyer make of it? So when one person's software interacts with another person's software, it can use a chain called an API for my software to interact with yours. But what does that create? That creates a data sharing relationship. So if I am ever having any other person's API, it's easy to get it on code, but I need an agreement and I need systems in place to manage, store, and control that data. Okay. So that is what we are going to need. We will, as lawyers, we will need to get more skilled in reviewing business work and in understanding the technicalities of how technology businesses run. If a bank is doing KYC, today you could say, if it's an offline account, that bhai, RBI has said what to do. You just follow the procedure, get those documentations done. But tomorrow you will have an NBFC saying, hey, this is work from home time. We are doing a remote Airbnb type of verification. If you have used Airbnb, you can create a virtual account and you can upload your document and verification. Everything is done virtually. But Airbnb does this only for its basic diligence, and it's not regulated by a bank to do, not regulated under any sector to do this. That is one of the good models we have. If an NBFC starts doing it, then you'll have to comply with RBI's guidelines that are applicable to NBFCs for that. And then you will, now how do you check whether this is compliant? You can't just ask a business guy a question. You'll have to read the guideline, interpret it. The business guy says something, then you review the software. Today, what happens is that when you do a due diligence for an investment transaction, you review the contracts. And for certain things, when you don't have confirmations, you ask the management team the question and you say it in your report that we asked the management team this question and they said that this is what is going to happen. And in your report, there's a disclaimer that everything is based on what the management team has said. Okay. That will not work and not fly in case of technology related laws. Whether even in a technology investment, people may say that I need proper last GDPR audit report or PDP if the bill is passed, the personal data protection audit report. Okay. And lawyers on a regular advisory basis will need to study and review business models for legal compliance. Okay. And so this is another part. Deyasini and Shivrit, we'll come to internships. Okay. I have it in the agenda. Thanks for voicing your question. So just stay on this conversation and we'll come to that. Okay. Now, another question. Some people have stopped hiring. Some people have not stopped hiring. Some people have given pay cuts. So it's a very volatile and fluctuating space. But one thing is clear, that when people are just about figuring out how to work remotely and collaborate with teams, they will be ill-prepared to handle an online hiring, training, and onboarding process, right? So what happens in a usual scenario? If I hire you, I have you in my office. You're in the system. You're in a box in the office. So I can trust the fact that you're working. I can lock out Facebook, everything from your system, and I know you're working. Uske baad, you may be incompetent, but you will struggle, and you are expected to have certain interactions just by being in the environment of office, which will make you learn and grow. So even a chaotic and unstructured training will make you learn things. In fact, most trainings have so many holes, so many layers of gaps that are filled only with regular periodic interactions, which are accidental and serendipitous in the office because the design of the office system is like that, right? You have your colleague nearby, you have sutta break, smoke break, lunch, tea, all of that, office parties. So people interact, get to know each other. That's not going to be so common, at least right now. Okay. So when these things are going to happen, then people are going to resist hiring people and training them in a work from home mode unless they have set processes for this and unless their business is rapidly scaling up. Right. So hiring remotely is challenging, whether it is on a full-time basis or a part-time basis or interns even more so, because in any law firm or any organization, when interns go for 1 month, they don't even get any work. Sometimes they don't get trained. Sometimes they don't get work. It's a regular problem. Okay. And still I am seeing how fixated people are on the idea that I'll get an internship and it'll work. I should learn more by getting internships. You know, it's like drinking water from a well in which water is over. Empty well you want to go. It's like an oasis. Not oasis, it's like a mirage. A mirage in the desert which looks like water and then it vanishes the moment you appear close to it, right? That's how it is to think that I'll go to an intern and learn. To go to an internship and learn. Now, what does this mean? What are we going to do? So people are... You understand when there's a hiring process that's being carried out, you apply to a lot of places, they look at your CV, shortlist you, call you for a meeting. There's a lot of effort in that. And then they interview you. Now, especially if you're looking for your first job, second job, third job, freelance assignments, these are cut off completely, right? So what do they want? They want people who can do the work. And everybody's only going to talk about ROI, right? Return on investment. What are you going to do for me? So unless young lawyers are able to talk, young professionals or any professional is able to talk that language, nobody is going to engage them, whether as an intern or an associate or a partner, it doesn't matter. Because people have no other way to get to know you. How are they going to come to know you? And which is why right now, because things are uncertain, those of you who haven't got any responses is because people don't know whether I'm supposed to hire or not. They don't know how long the lockdown will continue. Now the question is, do you want to sit back on the face of this uncertainty or do you want to take the reins in your hand and go forward? If you choose to go forward, then what can you do? Because if you decide to lay back, understand that it's going to destroy you mentally. Imagine every day wondering what is going to happen to my internship. Your morale is going to sink lower and lower and lower every day. Okay. Now, the other way to look at it is take the storm on its head. So what are the things that you can do to take the storm on its head? Okay. Imagine that they don't know when their office is going to run, right? But one thing everybody knows is I have work that I need to be done. So if I get someone who can do the work, I will engage them. If I can't pay, I'll tell them I can't pay, but I am definitely interested in engaging such people. Now, how do I go about doing that? For one thing, I need to make the hiring process very easy for people. So I need to take the recruiter's hiring cost away. So what does a recruiter go through? Or any client who needs help on legal work or CA accountancy work or secretarial work, they have a discovery cost, right? They have to find the people who can do it. Most of you are not in a place to advertise. So you're not advertising like Netflix. You don't have holdings up in the city. You're not advertising like Zomato or any other such company. So people have a discovery cost to find. You've got to reduce their discovery cost. How can you do that? There are social media channels, YouTube, video, TikTok, everything is there, which allows you to have a public presence, public identity, so that you can organically be discovered by people who are looking for content on that area. The way people discover you is different on different channels. Like in Facebook, people will discover you through their friends' networks. So personal relationships and the degrees of linkage between people are important. In LinkedIn, it is similar. And plus, you can use tags. So people who are relating to that same tag, who tag use a particular hashtag, they might end up discovering you. Google is completely different. There it's purely on the basis of content and no relationship. So in Google, what you have to do is write on topical issues which your client may be searching for or which your potential recruiter may be searching for. Usually, if you're writing for potential clients and you send that thing to a recruiter, they're very happy about it. Okay. So if you want to be discoverable on YouTube, discoverable on Google and YouTube, you've got to use subject matter expertise. You have to use the client's language, not case commentary on this case, but can we now start cryptocurrency investments because the stock markets are down? Like that is something that a client will be interested in. If you're using Facebook, LinkedIn, one thing for sure is you've got to widen your target audience. Add people you don't know, doesn't matter. Add them, keep adding 50 new people every day. And post content which may be relevant. You can post it on your wall. You don't necessarily always have to share it with them. Okay. Find 10 potential recruiters or potential clients every day, add them to your LinkedIn. And at least as much time as you spend worrying about the world, spend time thinking about what is this guy's top priority going to be. If you don't know it, you can do something very simple. Write on your LinkedIn that what are the top priorities of an entrepreneur running restaurant business today? You know that the business is going to be in deep trouble right now. So what are his top priorities going to be? Ask in your network. So your network has to be big, right? To be able to ask. So you ask them. Now, this entire, I know we've been talking about privacy and stuff, but here, this is the reverse of it, okay? Here, you have to be leaving behind a long digital documented trail of your activity to be able to build your network and to be able to build your expertise. You might think that if I'm the one asking what problems people face, then how am I an expert on it? But you're not an expert on it today, but after 5 days, you might become an expert on it because nobody else asked that question. Nobody else cared to find out the problem and nobody else cared to solve it. If I solve two problems or one problem every week, in 3 weeks, I will be an expert on three problems relevant to three sets of people. Okay, that's good. If you want a job as a corporate lawyer, identify what corporate lawyers are going to do. If you want a job as an employment lawyer, identify what employment lawyers are doing right now. Okay, employment lawyers are looking at whose salary can you cut? How? Can you alter the terms of and conditions of engagement? If I can't do it under law, can I get employee consent to varying terms? Then I'm safe from a legal risk. If people are covered under standing orders, then I need to give them a specific notice before I adversely alter their terms. Okay, so this is what they are looking at. Now, there are some more things that I think you can do. Okay, and this is, we've been talking about article writing on LinkedIn, but a couple of things that I've not talked about earlier, which I want to talk about now, are creating a video CV of yours and doing free video sessions on Zoom and later on putting them up on your YouTube channel. And you can create a playlist on your YouTube saying that these are the things I do. And I want to bounce off these ideas with you. And also the challenge I'm facing is that when I'm talking about it, I don't think everybody is able to grasp how they can do that. They imagine it, but they are not able to find out a pathway to implementing it. So, one thing that you can do is create a video CV when you apply. So you have your CV, you have your covering email, but what is a video CV and why should we create it? Your video CV is basically your interview, right? Now, the other guy is not talking. So what are you going to talk about? You're going to talk about yourself, what you have done, your qualifications, 10 to 15 seconds, right? After that, you jump to the point. I'm looking for an opportunity in corporate laws. Here are the skills I have that I know that any client looking at investment law work is going to either do. Any client, any investor is going to look at two or three investment structures. The possible investment structures in an investment transaction are an investment agreement, or if it's M&A transaction, there could be BTA, there could be asset purchase. Okay, these are the types of structures I know of. You may miss out also. You may not mention that the court approves mergers exist or they don't. So it can be imperfect. That doesn't matter. But when a person is listening to you, they can see a short snippet of who you are. They will be able to see what you know and what you've done. Okay, so they get a sense of that thing. They don't have to call you and say, hey, can you come on Zoom for an interview? Because they already know that, you know, what, who they are talking to, what is the level of maturity that person has. They'll know your non-verbal cues also, even though you're not in front of them, because you've recorded a video and sent them, they will be able to understand that. Another thing you can send them, especially if you're a LawSikho student, is one of the solved assignments that you have done. So if you are writing that, you know, I know, if you're saying, I know how to draft a share purchase agreement, how to draft an amendment to a standing order, I know how to draft a RERA petition for refund, let's say, then you can send them a sample. Look, this is what I drafted and this was the exercise given to me. Okay. Now, maybe you can say that employers don't have time to read it, but understand that it's going to take lesser time for them to just open the attachment in preview in their email box versus calling you up, following up, setting up the interview. Nobody wants to do that. They are getting like messed up managing day-to-day work. So if they could just see you immediately and in 10 seconds decide, achha, isko, let's call, that's going to cut the deal for them. That's what they want to know, right? And imagine if you send them 10 of your drafts and you've said in your CV, these are the skills I have, and in your video CV, you have said this. Then what's going to happen is that they may not even check your drafts much. They'll see this person has sent me 10 attachments. And what are the others saying? The others are sending me their CV and they're saying, please give me an internship. And look at this person. He's saying what the clients want. Okay. And what skills he has. He's promising me to be relevant. Then most of you like who are writing to me about internships, I know that you get stuck with follow-ups because you don't know, am I rude when I'm following up? How do I follow up? Do I say, did you get a chance to open my email? Or do I say I'm reattaching my CV? What do you say? Now, this again is a big challenge, right? So what you can do here, very simple. When you follow up, if you're following up after 3 days or a week, if you're constantly learning, you can follow up with something you learned new, which may be applicable to them. So you may say that last week I just learned how to draft an asset purchase agreement. And I also learned about tax implications or VAT or GST implications of asset purchase transactions. Here is a quick write-up that I'm sharing with you. And this is my, this is the draft of the asset purchase agreement I prepared. By the way, did you have any chance to look at my CV? We'll be happy if you could revert. Then no revert. Check up who is the recruiting manager. Check up the partner. Write to them on LinkedIn, attach the same document and the video again, okay? And ask for the same thing, okay? Bhavpreet, is video CV relevant for procuring freelance work? Definitely, because there you will not. So, you know, imagine, stop trying to be eligible for the throne of a big kingdom, okay? Just what you have to look at, you know, you don't have to say that I am getting a big opportunity by you giving me work. That's not how you have to say it, right? You have to say it by saying that I can provide you the value you're looking for and this is what I think you need. So when you are, let's say, writing to an entrepreneur in the food tech industry, you will talk to him around that. So your video CV will be customized, okay? You will never send the same video CV to everybody. It just doesn't meet norms, okay? Because then again, you will follow a lazy assembly line process. And that's exactly what the video CV is not about. Imagine if you were giving 4 law firm interviews, would you say the same thing in every interview? You'd do it 4 times. You'd never say the same thing. So why will you send the same video CV? Okay. Now I want to ask you, how many of you are comfortable or have practiced recording it and how do you do it? One simple way is to do it on Zoom. Like I'm recording this. If I didn't have any other participant, I could still record the video on my computer and edit it. There are free and paid softwares to edit. You can edit online on YouTube. You can edit on Filmora. which is has a free version, you can use your mobile phone to record a video scene. And you know, you don't have to put in great special effects. If you're doing a bad job in your first recording, you can delete it and re-record it again. Okay, because your mobile phones have editing, trimming, and timeline facilities. You can remove the first part or the last part of the video. But what will happen is you can't do a lot of fine-tuned editing. And you should not look at it. Let the video CV be as authentic as possible. So you may do a bad job for the first 5 shots. 6th shot will be good. As you keep practicing this, you will become very good at recording videos. I'll tell you what, from 2011 onwards till about 2016 to 18, it had been very difficult for me to record videos because I wasn't exactly sure what to talk about because I didn't have learners in front of me. Around 2016, I became a lot better, but it improved massively when we started having classroom courses in 2018 because I was speaking to people live in front of me. Okay. But, and by then I got so comfortable that I could speak myself in the camera, right? To myself or, you know, just record for an imaginary audience. So why now? See, I'm an educator, yes, but it doesn't matter. You also need to be educating your clients to get opportunities. And this is one of the best ways to do it. You will get better with practice. If you think you're a terrible speaker, well, there's only one way to improve: by recording. And you have no idea how much it pleases a recruiter who sees you speak. Okay, if you're a terrible speaker and you've still done this job, he will admire your courage to do this thing. Okay, people are completely blown away when they see that this guy has gone the extra mile and done something creative. You may be a bad speaker, but he sees your video CV. Next week, he sees your sample draft of a new skill. Next week, he sees something again. So if he doesn't give you a job, he will say, listen, I have this problem. Can you help me solve it? I'll pay you this much, or I can't pay you right now. Help me solve it and we'll see what I can do later. That's your first client or your first potential recruiter. Because when the lockdown goes off, who's the first lawyer he's going to approach, or CA or CS he's going to approach to get his problem solved? Now, whether it's a professional service you're providing for a freelance work, or whether you're looking for a job or an internship, you're going to be the first person he thinks of. So what you want to count right now on is how many new openings do you create for yourself like this? Because guys, what's going to happen in June, July? Nobody knows. Nobody is willing to bet on it. So yes, you can study now, but in addition to studies, what are the assets you are building for yourself? Imagine if I am doing, like, you can see we started about 10 days back with a target that we want to do one public webinar every day because we want to share learning freely, right? And earlier we used to have 3 webinars a week. Now we are having 2 to 3 in a day. Okay. Because we know that we will not always get the same opportunity. When everybody is going to office, you guys may not be able to turn up. But when you get free, you will look that up. But right now is the time to interact with you. Okay. So this will become useful later. Okay. People who want to find out about us and learn more about what we do will be able to find that out. Now, you can do the same thing for your practice. Those people who want to know about who you are and what you do, and people are going to increasingly resort to online. And today, if you offer to somebody that I'll do a free Zoom meeting, free legal health checkup, or free audit preparedness checkup, or free GST audit preparedness checkup, or free checkup of the integration between accounts, secretarial, and legal, okay, or I'll do a free data protection diagnosis, or I'll do a free training for all your managers on how to handle data. You may not have any certification. You might suck actually, okay? But it's a free first training that you are having. He doesn't have to pay you. As long as you're not giving pathetic advice, wrong law. Forget advice. As long as you're not educating on the wrong basis, like you should not be saying that Australian law applies in India. Okay, as long as those fundamentals are in place, they will really value what you're saying. And guess what? You don't have to be prepared before you get the gig. I call this a gig because that's an engagement, an assignment that you have from others. You don't have to be prepared before you got the assignment. You can prepare afterwards also. Okay. And I'm going to share a little secret that we use to always prepare ourselves for any corporate assignment. Okay. So one of the processes that we have is to crack a corporate deal, we have something called a requirement analysis form. Okay. So earlier, I've shared this in one of my webinars earlier. What happens when you're doing work for an individual is that an individual wants a lot of stuff. So you can make the biggest, grandest syllabus and prepare it and give it to an individual because he learns a lot of stuff, can apply it in multiple scenarios. For a company, the problem statement is very specific and very narrow. It may be deep, but the number of points are very narrow. Okay, now we've learned from a string of failed proposals until we got a string of successful proposals that when somebody asks for a proposal and you just give a proposal with a price quote, it doesn't work in all industries. You got to start engaging with them. So what we do is, if we understand the requirement perfectly, we skip this test. But if we don't, we send a requirement analysis form where people get down in the client side. Okay, it's very easy for us to say, "Bhai, client only doesn't know what they want." But that's not something that will help us get the deal. So we say that, okay, if there could be three decision makers on the client side, let them all get together and be very clear on what they want. So we send them a requirement analysis form with the specific questions that we think that will give us the answer. Okay, this is the pain point they have. So they do a joint exercise and they fill it up and they send it back. Now what happens is, whether we crack the deal or not, they know that we have, that when they did this exercise, they realized much more deeply about what they want done. So people who are thinking that, you know, this should happen at the cheapest price and this problem should get fixed, are suddenly aware of a new world that, okay, if I get this training, it might be for my team, it may be really valuable for us. And price is the second thing that we need to think of, not the first thing. So let us first see what we want to do. Okay, so that puts price on the backseat. Why I'm sharing with you this thing is because a lot of you are conscious when clients come to you, they say that, yeah, yeah, 5,000 rupees GST filing has to be done. Okay, so that's the time when you can think of it, that there are certain services over which you can add a value add on top of it. Okay, that, okay, can I also look at your past returns and see if they are aligned? So maybe you'll do it for free now and it'll be additional work, but for the next time, you will know which additional service to offer. So you will get more information about your client's business. These are very good ways. Offering a free service is a very good way to come to know about what your client does and what he wants. Like if you do a data protection free training, you will come to know what your client, what they will pay for. Then you can even do things like preparing process documents. You can prepare PPTs with voice notes. You can do lots of stuff and charge them. Okay. Now, maybe your parents will say that, what kind of a lawyer or a CA are you? You are doing bloody trainings and you're not going to the court and you're not doing audit. Then what are you? Okay. But I am not getting into that. I think that if I am providing useful service with the use of my skills, then I am a worthy lawyer. Right. And in fact, this is what has happened today. Right. If you were a true blue, pure and pure litigator alone, 21 days, you'd have had no work. And litigators have been hit badly by the lockdown. The ones who are able to survive are those who have had a corporate practice or a contract related practice. Okay. Where transactional work keeps happening. So, we have to be alive to this, that things are changing and this change will be lasting. There will be lasting impacts. What's going to be in our advantage is that geography is going to stop to matter. Face-to-face meeting with a handshake and meeting you in your office and having tea with you is not going to matter as much to get a deal from you as is an interaction. So people won't say that if you're doing a meeting with me on Zoom, you are a miser with respect to your time, right? What does that mean? That you are not in Delhi, Bombay, you can't meet the best clients, but you can do a Zoom call with them and give them superior service from wherever you are. Okay, now this is a one-to-one meeting. Obviously, it will not be public, but what will you do later? You will put it up on, you will put some learnings from what clients want on YouTube. You will ask that on your LinkedIn, that I identified that in a lot of IT companies, the managers don't know how to use data. So while the contracts are watertight, the managers are not able to implement the contracts. So the purpose of data protection law fails. Has anyone else had similar experiences? Please share. That's when you start. And or you can ask, can I speak to somebody who's had similar experiences? And that's when you will come to know more about the industry. Now, okay, the first trick that I was telling you was the requirement analysis form where people get down to send you the requirements. That will enable you to get more narrowed down on what they want. Give them a proper proposal that is helpful. Okay. The second thing we do is after a proposal is accepted, we talk to 3 to 4 participants of the intended training to identify what their current level of knowledge is. Okay. So that we know where we need to add maximum value to be successful. Okay. If you do that with a client also, it's going to be terrific. Because that is exactly the touch point that a client needs to understand that you are familiar with their business. You are building that comfort factor. So then they can start trusting you. This happens every time. Okay. People like the fact that we talk to 3 or 4 people from their company before we do a corporate training, because then they know that, whatever these guys are going to offer is going to be good. And sometimes because for many companies taking a corporate training on legal is new for them. They haven't engaged this, right? So we guide them through the process and we say that, okay, what's your review process going to be? We can do 1 or 2 iterations, but who's going to review? We ask them and they may not know. So they may say, okay, I am going to sign off. So then we can say, okay, then please take inputs from everybody and give us consolidated inputs. So that the coordination doesn't lead to a breakdown. Because imagine if 4 people commented on a document at 4 different points in time, we'd be left not being able to complete and ship a project. Now, how did we realize this? We'd realize this through trial and error, and we also fixed it on the go, but we did not know we are supposed to do it like this. I do not know another company who works exactly like this. We tried to find intuitive ways to move it to one level forward. And then we realized that after this much work, things work out usually. Okay, maybe when we have to do another 100 corporate trainings, we may realize new layers of processes that we can add to increase our success rate, okay, or to improve our pricing. So that is the kind of stuff you can do right now. So what you have to look at is that build additional interactions and trust with clients. It doesn't matter how much you know or how little you know. Also, one more thing is that when you choose a topic, like if you are a part of any community of entrepreneurs, or you can approach eSales to do virtual sessions with them. You should not just say, like you might be reading a module in business laws course on co-founders agreements or how to conduct a due diligence. So you could say, okay, I can conduct a session for you on what happens in due diligence and how founders should go about it. So that is one way of doing it. That is a generic way, will work. Another way to do it is that you specialize to the sector and the companies that exist there and do a training for them. So suppose an IIM incubator has only tech-related startups. So you can say that what should tech-related startups know about contracts? Okay, now you don't have a very specific chapter in a regular contract drafting course on this, but you have enough to be able to make a customized presentation for them on this. Because we teach you some technology contracts in the contract drafting course. There's a separate technology contracts course which teaches you all the gamut of technology contracts that can exist, like a substantial number. Okay, which was just launched 2 days back. Now, what happens? You may not feel that I know everything, but you should know that if I say this topic, they are going to say yes. Guaranteed, they are going to say yes. Okay, so that is what you have to pitch to them. When they say yes, then you have to figure out how you can add value, right? Now, Mahesh is asking about, okay, so somebody is saying time limit for video CV. I would say what's a good way to look at it? Look at Instagram videos. 1 minute teaser, and after that, the longest possible is, I think, 10 minutes. Earlier, it used to be 4 minutes. Okay, so keep this in mind. 1 minute, what can I say? 4 minutes, what can I say? If I want to explain a concept to somebody, I can try doing 4 minutes on an agreement, how to negotiate an investment agreement for an investor. Okay, or how to get FDI approval for your project, whatever. That can be 4 minutes. Because if somebody wants to test your knowledge, they can hear it and understand this guy knows it. If you want to tell them about yourself, that should be 15, 20 seconds and move into what your skills are. Okay. Template and sample video or video CV is what I want you all to write on this chat and think about what would make a good video CV for yourself. Okay. So maybe one of you could also give a 15-second video introduction part of your video CV right away. And Nachiket, this is important. Huh? Your question is very important. You had clients who wanted complicated contracts for pennies, though you tried to explain to them zero knowledge about their own problems. So I don't know exactly what to say on the face of it. Usually when this happens, it's because either they don't value, they are themselves not in a position to pay for anything and they are just panicking and saying everything. So that means the other side of it is that you've not been able to get deep enough with them about what they would value. Other thing could be that they don't generate any money. So they would never be good clients for you. Okay. And the third possibility could be that they do not value what service you're offering. So what happens with a client is that you have to walk them through layers of conversations for them to be able to identify the value you're providing. Often that doesn't happen the first time you do it. So you might do one contract cheaper, but look at raising the bar. I'll give you an example. And you know, a lot of you think that if I am giving a discount or offering my service cheap, then people are going to take me for granted and it's going to be a downward spiral. But that's not been the case in so many scenarios. Take any example of Uber or Make My Trip or Clear Trip. They used to charge barely any booking fees, Make My Trip and Clear Trip. Now they charge 300 or 200 per passenger per way. Okay, so there's so much additional money they are able to charge. Now they've increased their prices. Uber increased their prices by a big order of magnitude, right? Their fare hikes and all of that after giving discounts. Once they got the customer stuck and they increased their prices. There are many online learning softwares which have increased their prices. We used to use animation tools which used to be like really cheap and now they have become, they've gone outside. They have increased their price like 10-fold, 15-fold, 20 times. There was this free tool called Trello, project management tool. Trello has what it used to offer 10 years back. Now it is offering that at $15 per user. Okay, Jio has increased prices, Rajiv. That's correct. So it's not necessary. Like every new deal is a fresh deal. Okay, what is important is when you get a lesser price, you should know and you should communicate to the other person that where the value is and how it's going to be more the next time. And in that journey, you might realize that, okay, my client doesn't value this, instead he values that. Okay, he doesn't value X, he values A. So you give him A next time. Okay, because you will come to know that. Okay, so Karan, yeah, Trello is very effective. And if you have a team exceeding 10 people for unlimited use, it is $15 or $10 per person per month, which is insane. Like it's more than probably you'll get a physical office for that many people cheaper in India than the remote tool. Okay. But then there are counter arguments to that the level of analytics that it offers on projects, which it's much sharper than what an individual can do in a physical office. Yeah, Rajiv, Coursera. So what else? Okay. So this has been basically my planned intention for this. So there is one more idea I want to just go through with you, that there was there's a strategy, like what people try to think is that let me get the final best video shipped. That's not important. Let me get the best article up out there. No, right now what you have to practice is you have to document your journey. Okay, there is Gary Vaynerchuk who explains this. So you don't have to always create new stuff. Okay, you have to document your journey of doing it, and this is what counts. And when you are even giving an interview, when you document your journey of becoming an expert or identifying the pain points of clients, you might know zero law, but the recruiter and even the CEO, if they are interviewing you, or the CFO interviewing you, or whoever is hiring you, or the business guy who's going to give you work, they will appreciate the fact that you know ki problem kya hai. Then they can see your solution. But if they feel that you are not just connecting with the problem at all, then it's not going to matter. Okay, so documentation is important. Now I'm going to ask you to give me some structure about what you would like to say in your video CV. And Harshal, see, this is... what is the value added service you could provide them? You said you asked them on LinkedIn regarding the value added service you can provide them, explaining in detail by sending a PDF, but didn't reply a single one. Get reply. And how to follow up during this lockdown. So think now about what will not cost them at all. Okay. why don't you do interviews and create a book, a free ebook of 50 pages, okay, on how to pitch to angel investors during lockdown. Are angel investors investing? So what will happen is that you will come to know about them. They will be happy to share this with you. It doesn't cost anything. Okay. After that, when this is sorted, then you will have many more opportunities to pitch to them or to their startups. One thing angel investors struggle with is doing the diligence and investment documentation. And they often ask the founders only to find some law firm or lawyer to do it. Okay, and it's at the company's cost. So if you can be there on their panel and you can let them know, I can help you out anytime with this. I can help you with some new things. So even I don't know offhand that what are the new things other than this that you can help them with, right? But the point is that how can you get to knowing what you can offer them from not knowing? Okay, and Harshal, the first thing may not be money to start with, but the first thing is because you ask, right, that how do I build my network? How can it be so powerful? So how that's a question for all of you. So you will ask them this, that the investment climate during lockdown and the future, angel investors will happily contribute. What do you need from them? 15 minutes of time, man. Okay. And imagine how much insights you will have on this. You'll have more insights than a law firm. Law firms will say that investments are drying up. You will say that, hey, you're saying that, but actually I know the inside story. This is the plan for investors. I've spoken to 50 of them. Okay. So imagine this. Okay. You did no work for angel investors. You got this insight from angel investors and you know how to do investment deals. You tell a law firm about this or you tell a company about this. Do you think they'll be happy that you, do you think they will think you know more than the others? Harshal, what about you? Rajiv doesn't think that they will know more. Rajiv doesn't think so. Okay. Why, Rajiv? They will not be happy. A potential client will not like that. Okay, video CV structures. And I want this assignment, this conversation to have a takeaway for you. So what you're going to do, not takeaway, a task for you. What you're going to do is start to document your journey, currently what you're doing, okay? Not just saying, oh, we are in phase 3 and now there's going to be a community outbreak and government is doing this, that, not just that, okay? You are going to get to the details of what you're going to find out for the industry and for the sector. Okay, the government is not the only smart entity in the country. We also have to do our job and figure these things out. Rajiv, what are you saying? It would be an idea of another angel, another investor. No, this is your idea, Baba. The people don't mind. If you do a lot of research and you know the sector, they don't have a problem. The whole structure of a shareholders agreement, the whole structure of the syndicate loan agreement, that's not prepared by law firms from scratch. The Asia Pacific Loan Market Association is an association of industry, okay, all banks who have come together and created a standard format loan document. Yet law firms use it and bill their clients by lakhs and maybe crores for those transactions. Okay, so it's the idea of somebody else, but every day it's being practiced because it's become market standard. It doesn't matter. Okay, I'm going to review a few structures quickly. I forgot your name. You had given me your name. Radhika, how they will grab the opportunity, how to grab the opportunities this way. Yeah, you document your journey, expand your network, share, find out new problems. Create videos, send selfie videos to people. Say, I'm going to work online and say, you don't have to train me. Make sure you say, you don't need to train me. You don't need to train me. I'm going to do the work. And if nothing works, tell them, can I help you manage ongoing projects for free? Okay, Radhika. I am video CV structure. Intro about yourself, the internships you've done, the paper presentation and research papers you did. Okay. But you have to ensure that it's relevant to the firm. So what happens is a lot of times you do NGO internship, trial court, Supreme Court internship, and then corporate law firm. So that corporate law firm internship, for it, when you write that this is your internship experience, it doesn't matter to them. because you think that as per your structure, it makes logical sense to intern with a corporate law firm in the third year or fourth year for the first time. But if your CV has nothing about corporate, it doesn't make any sense to the law firm. Okay, Parikshit, you have undergone 5 internships and the last one, you have learned a lot about double tax treaty and direct tax-based work. Okay, great, Parikshit. So can you write to me? I'll give you a small project to take up if you want. Okay, just write to me separately on my phone number. So this is my regular number, my WhatsApp. I want more structures, but okay, one more structure for video CV. This is my WhatsApp number. I'm sending it. So Parikshit, you are saying this to me. That's your video CV structure. I'm so sorry. Okay, but what have you learned? Yeah, you said you worked on direct double tax treaty and taxation based on profits and gains from business. But what have you learned? How can you help a client? What's the repeatable advice you can give? Okay, get more detailed. Insight into what drives you and what you're looking for, you can, but you have to make sure that what drives you and what you're looking for is what the firm is, the kind of people that the firm wants. Otherwise, they will, like, if you just say, I'm passionate, I'm hardworking, it doesn't help. If money drives you, how does it connect with the firm, right? But if you say, I'm very clear that I want to do really good work and earn money, and I'm learning all the skills necessary to be of value to a corporate client, these are the list of 10 skills that I have. Okay. And here is a sample video of one of the skills that I possess and how I can use it. For example, I understand how to draft a franchisee agreement. I worked on an exercise where we had to draft a franchisee agreement for an entity in the apparel sector. The entity was based in US. They had an Indian subsidiary to whom they had to give a franchisee. The franchisee entity in India could sub-franchisee it also, but they had a list of standards to be kept to give to every other sub-franchisee in different cities. The territory of every franchisee was divided. The criteria had to be determined in onboarding. And what the firm's experience was in the past was that there was a string of failed franchisee arrangements because they had not clearly identified territory, IP rights. They had not identified maybe the training process. Okay. And they had not inserted enough protective clauses such as ABCD, whatever. Okay. Now that is what I worked on. And these are the clauses I drafted. A draft is attached separately. That way you have to say, okay, so that it's very bang on as to what you can do. First year students, it doesn't matter if you do have or do not have experience, you can start getting it. The entire point of documenting this journey online is to start getting the experience by talking to people. And you can take up any course on LawSikho. In 1 month in technology contracts course, you learn how to draft 14 technology contracts. In a regular course in 3 months, you will learn 24 skills. Every week you learn 2 skills. Most people in an internship of 1 to 2 months learn about 2 or 3 contracts maximum. Okay, I see people's CVs every day. So they've got all the right internships, but they do not know which skills they have and they are not able to express it because they could not see the work they did as a skill. So there's a tremendous opportunity for you to improve on that. Okay, and it doesn't matter which year you are in. The earlier you start, the better it gets. Okay, great. Provide a sample, Mahesh, of the how do you do litigation management. Okay, and you can give them a free questionnaire which they can internally use. You can say that you can optimize your decisions or maybe you can optimize decision making by 30% using the checklist I have. Please share it with your CFO and this person. Okay. And feel free to get in touch with me for anything. That's what you can say, Mahesh. Great, Karanya. These should be relevant to the purpose of the firm. Okay. So I'm going to call it a day now. Thank you everybody for being there. I'm going to invite you to share inputs on chat and also rate the session out of 10. Do you want more such sessions? I didn't have a guest speaker because these are some experimental ideas that we are trying out. And I want you all to benefit from the latest that we're discussing. And I would like to acknowledge and mention Ramanuj's name because he has been looking at a lot of this, you know, development as to where the industry can go. And we discuss this every day with him. So I thought that I will share about it with all of you and add my ideas and go ahead. Okay. And in case you want to contact us about how you can increase and improve your learning, you can let me know. Hi, Karan. Thank you for the joke. This is Abhyuday from Koma's account. Okay. Okay. Thank you very much. Cheers and see you, everybody. You have my number above in case you want to figure out what to do next in your career. Feel free to reach out. If I've missed anybody's question, I'm sorry. You can write. Okay, Shivrit, which question did I miss? If you all want to, those who want to log off can log off. Those who want to stay can stay while I address Shivrit's question. Shivrit, can you paste your question again? There's a very long chat. I've missed a couple of people, it seems. Law students in context of internships, I told you, Shivrit, you have to apply online and you have to say you have the required skills and you have to say, don't train me. I am trained. I don't need. So what people think is without training, they think if you get an opportunity, you will work hard and learn. Don't do that. Say, I already know. So you have to be that good, okay? So you learn that and then say that I can do this work. I can do proofreading for you. Send me proofreading work. This is what I know about contracts. I can do free proofreading. Okay, that's the kind of stuff you need to do, Shivrit. If you want to reach out to SaaS startups, definitely you should do data protection trainings. Do some free, give them free checklists, free questions to identify what to do, and do free trainings on Zoom, okay? Virtual trainings. Deyasvini, you should be learning drafting irrespective of what happens in June, and you should have 5 new internship offers lined up to start remotely from June itself. Okay, you have 3 months, April, May, and June, and June. Okay, so that by July you're ready full on, and in this process, by June or July, you should be able to get virtual assignments, you should have a network, all of that. And you should have more internships. For that, you will have to learn the skills and get remote internships. No other, cannot sit and watch on their reply hasn't come. What do I do? No, you have to get more opportunities. Stay in action right now, okay? Skills that are relevant, Saswati, contract drafting skills, data protection. Also, a lot of things you will learn on the fly. Once you get a foot in the door and you do your free trainings, you will identify that different people need different things, okay? All right, we will do more of these sessions. Utkarsh, say again quickly what your suggestion is. All right, so I'm going to complete the session. Cheers, everybody. Please include such insights in other sessions. What does this mean? Don't know what you mean. Okay, when we have okay, Utkarsh. So the guest experts are usually there for a different kind of expertise that they share, and we are doing a different kind of reflection here. Okay, cheers, everybody. Take care, and let's see one another again. I plan to do this periodically. Bye. Stay safe. Take care. Keep learning. Keep improving your skills. Keep improving your network. Okay, bye.